Welcome back, AP. All right, timer is started. Now we can get after it. Okay, I don't know about y'all, but somehow this three-day weekend is more relaxing than a whole week off for Thanksgiving. Like, I don't know how it's possible, but apparently it is. Okay, so we left off in class talking about the structure of the French society, right? Talking about the big five causes of the French Revolution, right? Financial crisis, American Revolution, the Enlightenment, the ancient regime is falling apart, and the eroded power of the monarchs, right? So we got into the faltering ancient regime, right? The old order, right? We had the first estate, second estate, the everybody else, right? So we have all that stuff. And we got into the fact that the way things are looking right now, okay? The third estate pays 99% of the taxes. It's made up of three different people. It's got the peasants, the urban workers, and the bourgeois inside of it, right? And that the basic forever belief has always been like,
it's got to be the bourgeois versus everybody.
It's not actually true. What is really going on in the revisionist understanding that we have, and again, don't let anybody demonize revisionism to you. It's not a bad thing. It's actually a good thing. It means we understand things better. All right. So, and what research is now showing us is that the nobility and the bourgeois were highly fragmented and internally full of rivalries, right? So you had robe nobles and sword nobles that hated each other. You had bourgeois members who were close to buying their way into the nobility and versus smaller bourgeois families against peasants, against urban workers, against everybody, right? Like, it was basically pro-revolutionaries versus anti-revolutionaries. That's really what's going down in this entire thing, right? But big thing we now got to get into, though, is the eroded power of the monarchs, right? So we know that the Ancien regime is crumbling, right? We know it's crumbling because tax revenue is not proportionally situated. We know that 30% of the wealth, 30% of the land belongs to 3% of its population, right? We know that most economies are based off land during this time period, whether it be land allocation, land taxation, and or the economics created off of that land. So you've got 3% of the population owning close to 5% or like owning close to 95% of its wealth, but the other percent of the population which doesn't have as much of the wealth is expected to pay 99% of the taxes, right? Now, some of y'all are like, this sounds really familiar. It does, right? But it wasn't like the revolution then just blew up because of this financial instability. A lot of other things were going on, all right? So one of the biggest things that was going on is that the monarchical powers were falling apart, right? So no one, and I repeat, no one, rules like our boy, Louis XIV. Yes, that is correct. He is the master of puppets, right? So Louis XIV died in 1715, 100 years before the empire falls by Napoleon. Coincidence? I think not. All right, so Illuminati confirmed, just throwing it out there. Now, the big thing, though, you have to understand is that Louis XIV was able to rule in the way that he did, mainly due to the fact that he destroyed slash controlled these old things called the Parlements. All right, so say it with me real quick. Parlement.
Baguette. Baguette.
Ah! Stop! I could have dropped my croissant.
Exactly. One more time. Parlement. Let's really French it up, shall we? Almost maybe drop my croissant. Now, big thing though. Now, really with that though, Parlement, all right, Parlements are these groups of judges that enact royal decrees, right? So during Louis XIV's era, if he wanted to, ooh, this is a big one. When he revoked the Edict of Nantes, that had to go to the Parlements. And then they approved it, and then they distributed it. It's kind of like the leftover intendant system, right? So the intendant system under Richelieu was created to effectively carry out the practices of the monarchy, and that was, again, a form of the Parlements, right? So really quick, let me double check that actually. So apparently the Parlements had existed all the way since like the 12th century. So it's like since the Middle Ages. But the intendant system was like the big overarching way of how Richelieu was able to supersede these people, right? So without the intendant systems of Louis XIV that crashed and burned after his death, according to the research that I just did, then that's why the Parlements were not listened to, right? But now that Louis is gone, that all goes away. And so the old Parlements come back. They are the highest standing council of magistrates in the land. There's 12 of them for every single district, right? And there are 13 districts total, okay? So you have basically this large group of people that have a lot of power, and they're now getting it back because they have a weaker king, right? So every time Louis XV, the grandson of Louis XIV, would try to fix any debt brought on by war, wars like the War of Austrian Secession, the War of Spain Secession, the Anglo-Dutch Wars, the Seven Years' War, etc., the Parlements would crush any of his new tax ideas, right? Mainly due to the fact that the Parlements were manned by 12 high-ranking noble status families. If you understand what I'm saying, no noble wants to vote to pay more taxes because they're nobles. They like the fact that they keep making more and more money, right? So the Parlements, every time Louis XIV would be like, please? Like they would literally say, not doing it, right? So, and they would refuse to approve his taxation ideas. He would send them and they would be like, oh, we lost it. We don't know what happened. I guess we can't sign it. There was even one point during the Seven Years' War when they were accruing now even more debt. And then they also lost on top of it, right? So French debt was now at its highest it ever had been, right? And like there's one really famous incident when Louis XIV tried to pull a Louis, right? When Louis XV tried to pull a Louis XIV and made an attempt to create a law and order state and actually crush the Parlement power using his guy named René de Maupeou, who was in charge of his finance. Say it with me. René de Maupeou. And Maupeou actually created a coup, right? And a coup would like to create these things that I like to call puppy parliaments, right? He wanted to force them using military sanctions and also people pointing guns in their face to sign decrees passing taxes, right? But it still didn't work, right? So he literally had military officers and musketeers show up at the homes of these Parlement officers, and they still refused to sign things into action, right? So every single time it failed, right? And due to this, the press, that's right, Angelina, the newspaper is becoming a really big deal right now, is going to eviscerate Louis XIV is dead. I'm going to try to stop saying the wrong number. The press eviscerated Louis XV for trying to do this thing, right? For trying to bring the Parlements under their power, because the people believed that the Parlements were kind of an extension of themselves, even though they really weren't, right? So, and the press is going to tear them apart. And due to this, these things are going to shoot his authority in the foot, right? And commoners and wealthy people are going to begin to look at their king and they're like, this guy can't get anything done, right? So the power of the monarchs is eroding, right? It's eroding very quickly. And it's leading to this process known as desacralization, right? So now sacrament meaning a holy thing. So what's basically happening during all this back and forth of, oh, the Parlements are back and they refuse to do more taxes. Oh, I'm going to point guns at them until they agree. Oh, they still didn't agree. And all this other stuff going on. That divine right of kings thing that was a part of the absolutist era when people literally thought that Louis XIV was the sun king and sent by God, not anymore, right? Desacralization basically means the power of the monarchs was going from people believing that God appointed them to thinking that they were just really annoying dudes that couldn't get the job done, right? So, like, we got a big problem going on right now, right? The Enlightenment is exposing people to new ideas, and these people are like, you kind of stink at this job, right? Like, so they're like, you can't even get wealthy people to pay more taxes, and you want to try and like string me out for every bit of tax money I have, right? So like, of a lot of big problems, right? So the monarchical power is falling, okay? No AP test is ever going to ask you about really much of the anything outside of the parlements, right? Understand the fact that they've created a big problem for the monarchs, right? When Louis XIV dies, his intendants carried out his ideas over the parlements, and but once he's dead, they're all gone, and then the old parlements are now back, right? And these parlements put in a very big headache for Louis XV, and he couldn't pass anything. And what's going to happen is Louis XV is going to die at about the age of 64, right? Which at the time was kind of early for a king, right? Because I think Louis XV died at 70-something, right? Still pretty cognitively available and everything. Now, but Louis XV also didn't reign for nearly as long as Louis XIV did, right? Louis XIV was just like the guy. He was the absolutist man. He was the one that even Voltaire himself loved, right? Voltaire, the guy that Louis XV probably should have enlisted to write some satirical evidence about all these nobles not doing what they were supposed to be doing, but he didn't know who to call. It wasn't the Ghostbusters. Now, look, but the big thing, though, okay? Louis XV is going to die at the age of 64, right? Which was early for a king, which means that his 20-year-old grandson is now going to take over, right? So 20-year-old Louis XVI takes over in 1774. And what kind of problems does this man have? Crazy amounts of debt, crazy amounts of issues, nobody likes the monarchy anymore, this poor guy, right? Like, honestly, Louis XVI is kind of a pity party, all right? Just to give you a heads up, I feel like Marie Rowley's gonna love Louis the Fifth. Oh my God, the number. Sorry, I feel we could just call him what his real name is, Louis Auguste. All right, Louis Auguste. Yeah. He was the Dauphin of France, right? But poor Louis the Sixteenth, man. Like he was a very quiet, mild mannered kid when he was growing up. He wasn't supposed to be king. His older brother was supposed to take over. This is a lot like a Charles I situation because their brothers both died when they were younger. Louis's older brother was like Louis. What was Louis' older brother's name? Let me look it up real quick. Louis Auguste, which is going to become Louis XVI. Born, burial, spouse, issue, house, father, mother. Louis August brother. Okay, there we go. Louis August brother. There we go. Would have been was overlooked by his parents in favor of his older brother, Louis Duc de Bourgogne. Okay, yeah, Louis de Bourgogne. So yeah, they favored his older brother, regarded as bright and handsome, but he also died at the age of 9. Now, anyway, so what unfortunately happens though is, so Louis the 16th, just like we were just saying, his poor brother died when he was 9 years old, right? He was handsome, he was athletic, everybody thought he was going to be king one day, but then he unfortunately died. So who does that leave the reign to? Oh God, Louis Auguste, who's over in his room playing with locks. All right, so Louis the 16th was obsessed with locksmithing, and he thought that was really neat, and puzzles and stuff. He was always really playing with kids way younger than he was. Some historians believe he may have had what we now call Asperger's, right? He may have actually had a form of social autism. We're not positive, but he did show some traits and signs of it. His writings are really, really kind of sad. He doesn't really know what he's doing. He loved to hunt, and that's really about all he really was good at. And then he also had to go off and marry a girl when he was 15. All right, so when he was 15 years old, he married this woman, Marie Antoinette, right? Marie Antoinette. Everyone knows Marie Antoinette. Marie Antoinette is the daughter of Maria Therese, the queen of the Habsburgs in Austria, right? And she is the sister of Joseph II, the guy that actually released all of the serfs, right? So, and then everything backfired. But then, I know some of you are like, oh, this makes so much sense. Yes, exactly. The Habsburg monarchs married their daughter off to the Bourbons in the hopes of actually cementing an alliance between them. And a lot of this has to do with the alliance shifting that happened during the Seven Years' War. Because some of you are like, I thought the Habsburgs and the Bourbons didn't like each other. Or I just thought French people and Habsburgs didn't like each other. They didn't for the longest time. Originally, the English had actually supported the Habsburgs in the War of Austrian Secession. And then when the British were like, hey, Maria Therese, maybe you should just give up the stuff that Frederick the Great is trying to take from you. They were like, meh. And then they turned their backs on the British and then allied with the French. And in the form of this alliance, they married their daughter off to the son or the crown prince of France, right? And I believe she was only like 14 when she got married. Marie Antoinette. Marie Antoinette. Yes, she was only 14. Let's go. All right, so. But yeah, that's a really intense setting for a girl to just be dropped into, right? She's getting married to a guy that I think was like 16 when he was his age, and she was 14, and he might have some type of social inabilities and stuff like that. And I'll tell you a story really quick later on in class. Just like ask me about it. Just be like, hey, Mr. Terry, you told us you would tell us a story about Louis and Marie. I just don't want to put it on the internet. All right, so like, but anyway. Also, fun fact, she probably never said, let them eat cake, okay? Like, we'll get into that later on. She never actually said that. Again, if you want to ask me about it, be like, Mr. Terry, what did she actually say? There's claims that she said something like, les étoiles brioche, which means, like, let them eat brioche, which is not, which is a bread for rich people, right? Because it's got butter and milk inside of it. So there's, like, some confusion. Some people think that Jean-Jacques Rousseau was the very first person to write that. But the problem with the fact is that this married couple has now been plopped into this idea because it's now way too late for the new Louis because the new Louis is way too soft, right? And the damage has already pretty much been done. The revolution was going to happen. By this point, revolution's coming. It starts in 1789. He's crowned in 1774. It's just a matter of time, right? He tries to keep it from happening, but he also married a girl who was considered very flighty and very irresponsible, right? Marie Antoinette spent a huge chunk of French tax money every year buying new dresses for herself and spending a lot of money. She even made like a pretend farm so she could understand the plight of the poor people, but mainly because like she just wanted to be around sheep and stuff. And it was built at Versailles, you know what I mean? Like, so this couple, not having a good time, right? And the American Revolution is going to further lead to even more problems, right? The American Revolution and the Enlightenment push that ball even further, right? Because the thing about it is it's going to have huge impacts on the revolutionary thought in both practicality and ideologically, right? Because the French supported the Americans, right? Which is going to bankrupt the crown completely. So the idea was that here's what we're going to do. We're going to support the Americans against the British, right? Because the British are our biggest economic rivals. The British took all of this trade from us during this whole time, and the only thing left we got is Saint-Domingue over in Haiti, right? So if we support the Americans, then we'll take a third of the British territorial market away, and they'll need trade partners. So who shows up to start trading the American goods? The French do. So the idea was that under Louis XVI, when he supported the American Revolution, that he would actually benefit from it because when they won, he would be the trade partner that the Americans turned to, right? The problem is, though, is that the Americans following a revolution that didn't end until 1781, that's right, he agrees to it in 1776 and has to wait until the war is over. Then he also has to give a bunch of the French Navy to them and French soldiers just to finish the war off. It's going to bankrupt the crown. They have no money left, right? They have 7 years to try and recoup all the debt that they've now accrued. It's not going to happen, right? The people thought the Americans were also BA, right? Like, so you have to understand, it's because they were Enlightenment ideas in action, right? They are Enlightenment ideas in action, and they believed in their cause. They were like, you're telling me the American colonists just stood up to the biggest and strongest and most powerful empire that the world has ever seen up to this point, and they did it based on Enlightenment ideas? Huh! The French people are super inspired. So ironically enough, Louis made a bad economic decision, and then it screwed him up ideologically because now his people all want a revolution as well. They're like, wait a minute, America can do it. We can do it. All right, so the American Revolution represents Enlightenment ideas in action, okay? I want you to leave six spaces underneath the American Revolution represented Enlightenment ideas in action. Be like, Mr. Terry, in class, don't let me forget, We have to talk about how those Enlightenment ideas play out because they're going to directly cause the French Revolution as well. And some of you are like, oh, is that Louis? No. This is the ladies' man of all ladies' men during this time period, right? This is the Marquis de Lafayette, right? I know a lot of you have heard of him before because he has a region in Louisiana named directly after the place that where he was born, the Marquis de Lafayette, the way you're supposed to say it, not the Marquis de Lafayette, all right, like the way y'all say it, all right? So now, but the Marquis de Lafayette is going to be the revolutionary hero, right? Like, he has a university in Pennsylvania named after him. He has a region of Louisiana named after him, right? He is the guy that represented the French military contingent in the American colonies, and he learned from Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Franklin, John Adams, Alexander Hamilton. He learned from all those guys what a revolution can be, and what is this right here? That is a tricolor cockade. That's right. The Marquis saw a revolution in action and was like, we can do this, right? But who is he? Where is he from? What estate is he from? This is what we're talking about with revisionist history. It's not bourgeois versus nobles. He was a noble. He's a Marquis, right? So the Marquis de Lafayette is a sword noble, right? You see the sword right here next to his hip? He was a sword noble. He represents some of the nobility that wanted the revolution to happen to strip power away from the monarchs, right? So it's important to understand the Marquis de Lafayette is the man. So now we have already gone through three of our causes for the French Revolution, right? We went through the crumbling ancient regime. We went through the Enlightenment and the American Revolution just now, right? We also just went through the eroded power of the monarchs, so we only have one left, right? And the last cause of the French Revolution is going to be this thing known as, oh, I don't know, financial crisis, right? And attempts to fix these issues all fail miserably, right? One of the biggest ones was actually this thing called the Assembly of Notables, which, why don't I have that? Oh, there it is. All right, so now look. So let's talk about the financial crisis in and of itself, right? So the financial crisis of France is going to revolve mostly around the fact of percentages, right? So this is going to get into a lot of math stuff, but we're going to revolve our ideas around the around common French tax income, right? So the current French government collects about $440 billion in taxes, right? So what do you think 50% of that money during the French monarchical era during the 1700s was going towards? I'm gonna say this. It should blow your mind, all right? 50% of all French tax revenue in the 1770s was paying interest on debt. That's right, Rufio! Stop. Sorry, he's licking. That's right. Just the interest on the debts, not the principal, not the payments on them. 50% of all of the French tax money was just paying interest rates. That's mind-blowing, all right? They are totally screwed. 25% of it was going towards the military and providing for the standing army, right? So 75% of your tax money is now gone, right? Gone. 6% was going to the crown so he could keep Versailles well-maintained and also so he could have court life, okay? So just to give you a heads up, that is the biggest one that he could have cut out, right? He could have cut that one out the most, but 50% going to interest, it's over, man. It's over. It is over. Like the revolution's going to happen. There is no saving this if 50% of your tax revenue is going just to save interest. But if we compare how much money the king was collecting for himself and for his courts and for his parties compared to the modern day tax revenue. So in the modern era, as of 2017, not as of 2017, as of 2019, the French government collects about $440 billion in tax revenue, right? So in the modern era, 6% of that is $26 billion, right? So he was collecting gobs of money just for himself. This is a big thing to understand. Louis wanted to fix these problems, but he didn't want to fix them that bad, right? So 19% is going to be used for everything else, right? That's right. That's right. This is impossible. That is not possible. You are not going to save this whole thing. This is not going to be an inspiring moment where the king comes down and he's like,
Let us strip all the land and the wealth from the nobles and save the people and let us eat the rich. That does not happen, right? So it doesn't happen. So he even tries some attempts, right? One of the biggest attempts that he actually attempted to fix this problem was he wanted to figure out, oh, well, what should we do? We should maybe, oh, I don't know, tax the first estate more? Should we probably just tax the first and second estates as much as possible? Probably, right? And so, and at the Assembly of Notables, he calls into action as many prominent figures of every single estate, right? Mainly just the first and second, though. He gets a couple of cardinals, he gets a couple of nobles, he gets a couple of marquises to show up, and when they get there, he's like, okay, I need a bunch of y'all to agree to pay higher taxes, so we can then tell the other rest of your estates to pay higher taxes, so they'll agree on it, and we can hopefully fix the immediate financial crisis before we descend into a revolution. This is the moment, and I need you to put a star next to this, okay? Is in 1787 at the Assembly of Notables, it could have been possibly prolonged, right? Like, it could have been, if Louis ever had a chance to save France from revolution, this was it. And looking at this political cartoon that was then released throughout every single French newspaper, again, the newspaper becomes so important. Angelina. All right, so now you have to understand, the Assembly of Notables was a laughingstock. Absolute laughingstock, okay? No one took it seriously. The people that arrived made the joke about Louis, saying that basically he was a wolf, bringing in the nobles and the clergymen, asking them how they would like to be cooked, right? So that's what's happening in this political cartoon. A wolf is sitting on the chair asking all of these ducks and like farm fowl, how would you like to be cooked, right? Like, so like basically everyone's saying that, oh, this king doesn't know what he's doing and he just wants to cook all of us and take all of our money from us, right? And then on top of all of that, Louis has terrible financial advisors, right? This one right here named Cologne, don't write him down, he's not important, is awful and represents the nobles and not getting anything done whatsoever. This guy right here is an actual abbey, so he actually had church officials with his financial advisors. Terrible idea, but then he has this guy, and he's very, very important. You need to jot this guy's name down. And I'm going to say it very slowly because he's going to be the guy that basically tries his best to save France from revolution. And the people of France, the third estate, begin to love him. Okay? They start to look at Jacques as being the guy that will save France because he is willing, because this dude is willing to call Louis out. And he's willing to be like, if we're going to save this, we got to do as much as we possibly can. Right? And his name is Jacques, J-A-C-Q-U-E. S, space, and then his last name is N-E-C-K-E-R, Jacques Necker, okay? So be careful when you're saying that word. Now look, so Jacques is then appointed as the general finance minister of France, and he does something that no one expected. He goes up to Louis and he says to him, your power is squat mostly because of your grandfather. It's not completely your fault, right? So your wife is a laughingstock. She's spending all of this money on all this stuff, and then she's making everybody look dumb, and she's really, really making the people of France mad. Three, the American Revolution is sending us into bankruptcy. The Enlightenment ideas are killing us. Four, the ancient regime is crumbling. And five, none of you're in financial crisis, and the Assembly of Notables, you were just laughed at. And so Louis looks at him, and he's like, well, Jacques, what do we do? And he's like, I'm afraid, sir, we have to call the estates, right? So, boom! This is a very major moment in French history. I cannot understate how big of a deal the estates general is. The estates general is wicked important, all right? So, like, it's so important, okay? The estates general is a council of members of every estate, where members of every estate, clergy, nobles, and all the third estate members arrive at Versailles. They are meant to arrive there in full regalia with an entire parade, and they are only called to the estates general in times of extreme crisis, okay? The estates general is a represented body that is only called in crisis when a public opinion is completely necessary, right? And it had not been called
for 173 years. And at the last time they called it, it was for financial crisis, and that's when the French monarchs put the land and salt tax on the nobles, right? So Jacques is hoping that if you can call the estates, then maybe we can turn enough of the first estate and second estate members over to the side of paying more taxes, and we can hopefully strip some land and money away from them to prevent the downfall of the country, right? But then the stupid parlements screw everything up again. And they were like, oh, okay, we're going to do that, but if we're going to do it, we're going to do it like we did back in the old days, and there's going to be three houses that each represent one estate, and they each get one vote. What? Yeah, so you're telling me that you want to now call a meeting. And this is not Jacques' fault. This is the fact that Louis allowed this to happen. Louis the 16th allowed this because he's not strong enough and not politically savvy enough to understand how to tell people to sit down and shut up. But he allowed this idea that we will call the first estate, the second estate, and the third estate to all come to the estates general to agree to discuss the financial crisis, but we're only going to allow each estate to get one vote. So you're telling me we're going to call a meeting where two of the three estates are never going to vote to pay more taxes, and you think this is going to be effective? Yeah, exactly, right? So it's not going to be effective because the estates general was messed up from the outset, right? The elected political different amongst them for each estate, right? So you had for the third. Okay, so what ends up happening is all the estates elect officials to go, right? They elect officials to go and they're like, okay, you're going to go represent the third. You're going to represent the third. You're going to represent the third. They elect all these people to go represent themselves at the estates, right? And a big, big parade happens, right? A huge parade happens. And then first estate that enters in is the clergy. And they all process in and they're completely royal bound through the front doors with their full dress on, flags in front of them, seals upon them, music playing, and then here comes, the music continues. And then in the front door, notice I'm saying the front door, and then in the front door, here comes the second estate, the nobles and the marquises, and they're all walking in, the dukes and the duchesses, and they're all walking in, and they all sit down, right? And then the music stops. And then here comes the pitiful third estate in a side door, all wearing black robes because they're not allowed to wear their really, really proud stuff, right? And is it going to be an absolute crapshoot? Not immediately, all right? So, like, it's not going to be immediately. It does take a while, right? It lasts for over a month. So early agreements are that absolutism is lame, all right? So, like, almost every single person at the earliest estates generals meetings are saying that, like, you know, the absolutism thing is kind of played out. The Enlightenment has taken hold. We don't need any of this anymore. We'll keep a king, but whatever. And Louis, to his massive dissatisfaction, has to listen to all this. But he's sitting there in the back of his mind being like, oh, well, I control the military, so I'll just keep it whether they like it or not. I just need them to agree to pay more taxes. So Louis's an idiot, all right? So, and then do away with mercantile laws. That makes a lot of sense. Adam Smith has exposed the fact that mercantilism isn't real. Okay, so mercantilism isn't real. Mercantilism is not real whatsoever. Mercantilism revolves around the idea that the amount of money in the world is finite, as in there's only X amount of money in the world, right? Adam Smith is like, no, money is a fabrication. It is a creation in our minds. We have created the concept of money, so it fluctuates. It can be grown. It can be shrunk. Inflation's a problem. Be afraid of that. But they're like, okay, let's do away with mercantile laws, right? So they want to bring in more economic competition. And the third estate's like, yes, we agree with this. Yes, we agree with this. This is a great idea. This, the first estate agrees with that, the second estate agrees with that, and then also more personal liberties, right? Freedom of the press, big one, right? Freedom of speech, big one. Freedom of property rights, big one. And everyone agrees. But then here come the disagreements. Because then everything was going fine, and then you got the taxes. And then when the taxes stuff come up, the nobles are all like, and then the church is like, I don't want to. And then like, but the third estate is very upset, and they stand up for themselves, right? And they're like, one, this is rigged, all right? So they're like, this is rigged. It should be based on population of masses, not necessarily one vote per house, right? They also disclaimed meeting procedures are dumb. You're making me come in through a side door and we're all black because you're basically making me like look like a dumb dumb like in this entire meeting, right? And then here's the other one, numbers.
So originally, you had certain numbers of each, right? Every first estate had X members for second estate, X members for the third. The double the third becomes the rallying cry, right? The third estate says, not only should we vote by head, as in every person here, we should also double the size of the third estate to make this fair because it represents the population numbers better. That way, as long as the third estate votes basically like a monolith, all you got to do is convert like six people on the other side and you can actually get things done. This is a genius idea, right? But it doesn't go very well, and the whole thing crumbles, and then a revolution happens, and we're going to talk about that in class. All right, so I'll talk to y'all a little bit later, but the big thing to kind of leave off on is this idea of double the third, right? Double the third, and we're going to talk about a propaganda war that happens after this, and it kind of blows up, and there's, look at there, there's our boy, there's Jacques, right? There's Jacques Necker trying to lead the entire thing, and then there's crusty old dumb Louis right there sitting up in the front, all right? So we will talk about that stuff a little bit later on. I'll talk to you guys soon. Y'all have a great weekend. See ya.